Wonderful. So welcome very much to the European Policymaker Forum on Advancing Vocational Training and Employment. I'm Ingrid HEINDORF from the World Future Council, and I'm doing the policy research and conference organization of the Zero Project. And this year we concentrated on employment policies, which was very exciting, which took us around the world. We had 48 nominations from all around the world, and 11 policies will be awarded tomorrow. But I won't talk about this now, because tomorrow is a big day. I hand over to Silvia, who's co-chairing with me.
Hello, everybody. Welcome again from my side. I'm Silvia Balmas. I'm working for the European Foundation Center. The European Foundation Center is an association, an international association of foundations. And it's basically a platform for connect, learn, and work together. And within disability, we have a group. A member of the group is also, one of the members is also SL Foundation. And together we are trying to mainstream disability in the philanthropic sector. So foundations aren't acting alone, but they like to work in collaboration with all the stakeholders of the society, and in particular with policymakers at the national, at the European level as well. So here we are in the right place, and I think we can start the conversation now.
Great. So to kick off this session, we would like our honorable members of parliaments and representatives of the European Commission to introduce themselves a little bit more to you. So to my left, I have Senator Martin Conway from Ireland. Martin, would you like to say a few words about yourself?
Thank you. Thank you, Ingrid. And again, it's great to be here in Vienna at the Zero Project Conference. And the topic this year is extremely important. My background is I am a visually impaired Member of Parliament. I'm the first visually impaired member of the Irish Parliament, the Irish Senate, and I'm on my second term. I was elected initially in 2011, and I did a five-year term, and I was re-elected last February. So I've a year of my second term done, and lots to talk about in terms of where Ireland has come from over that six-year period, and you know the hopes and aspirations. Like we are on the verge of ratifying the UN Convention on the Rights of People with Disability. It's going to happen within a matter of weeks, which is very exciting from an Irish perspective, and certainly long overdue, but given where we've come from in Ireland in the last 6 years, I'm sure you will appreciate it. It's a fairly significant milestone and a significant achievement.
Exciting times indeed, and our congratulations certainly to your re-election.
Thank you.
Now, turning to our right, there is Honourable Franz-Joseph HUAINIGG. Franz-Joseph, would you like to say a few words about yourself?
Yeah, I hope you can hear me. My voice is a little bit slowed down from the respirator. I'm a member of the Austrian Parliament, and I'm speaker for people with disability, for the People's Party, and I'm also speaker for international cooperation, and in my work I've also the perspective to engage myself in for developing cooperation and also for accessibility and equality rights. Yeah, and I'm in Parliament since 15 years. I became old in Parliament. But there are so many things to do that the time runs away. Yeah.
Thank you very much, and congratulations for also being 15 years in Parliament. That's certainly an achievement. And now to my left, the representatives of the European Commission, Immaculada Plasencia Porrero. Immaculada, would you like to say a few words about yourself?
Thanks, Ingrid. Yes, well, just as a brief introduction, my background. I started working on disability matters, focusing on research on assistive technology some 25 years ago at the European Commission. And from there, I've moved into policy and legislation. Now I am the person responsible for the European Accessibility Act, and which is under Digi Employment, and it is the unit that is responsible also for the implementation of the UN Convention, is the focal point for the Convention for the European Union. So I combine the accessibility with a wider tasks related to the Convention and the European Disability Strategy. Thank you.
Thank you, Immaculada, and thank you all the panelists for those introductions. I would like to start our panel with a question directed to both Mr. Conway and Huami. So you have been elected to the parliament, to the national parliament of Ireland and Austria. Were there any disability-related obstacles that you have to overcome in order to become and work as a member of parliament? Mr. Conway, please.
Absolutely. I suppose Ireland is a bicameral country. We have two parliaments. We have the lower house, which is known as Dáil Éireann, and we have the upper house, which is known as Seanad Éireann. Dáil Éireann is directly elected by the citizens in a PRS TV multi-seat constituency format. So effectively, various political parties will run more than one candidate because the seats are either four-seaters or five-seaters. So it's extremely competitive. Somebody like me who has an obvious disability, who can't drive and has difficulty recognizing faces, would find that system very competitive. I am elected to the Seanad, which is elected by other policymakers, county councillors, local authority members, or municipal district members, as to be known in some parts of Europe. And I get elected on one of those panels. So I'm dealing with what I would describe as a professional electorate, and I can tell my story to them and they see my performance. It would be my ambition to be elected to Dáil Éireann by the people of my constituency, which is County Clare, which is in the west of Ireland. And I would have a significantly high media profile. So, you know, in ways that I am disadvantaged in not being as mobile around the constituencies as I would like, and the difficulties obviously I have with recognition of individuals, I would try and make up for it by using the skills I have in terms of my media performance and my performance on television and radio. But the challenges are very significant, but as one of your speakers said earlier today, I look at the glass half full and not half empty. I see the opportunities and challenges that are out there rather than the difficulties and difficulties and disadvantages that are obvious and apparent. So I think with a positive attitude, it's certainly what drives me politically. And, you know, I believe I have a significant responsibility in Ireland to be a role model because we have 270,000 blind and visually impaired citizens in Ireland. We have 10% of our population, if not more, have disabilities. There are very, very few in Parliament. At the moment, I am the only member of either the Dáil or the Seanad, either houses of Parliament, with a declared disability, which is very, very poor in terms of representation, given the fact that 10% of the population are. And being the only ever elected visually impaired person out of the millions of visually impaired people over the decades from Ireland, it does, I suppose, point to the very difficult challenges that are there to get over the line and be successful.
Thank you very much. We believe the challenges are so much, but keep positive attitude. Absolutely. Yeah, is the message. Thank you. Mr. Huaming, what have been the challenges for you?
Huaining.
Huaining.
It's a difficult name.
Sorry.
How I came in Parliament. I was asked by the Chancellor Wolfgang Christ and Maria O'Callaghan was General Secretary of the People's Party, and she has a daughter which is blind, who is blind, and she thought that it would be important that that a member of parliament with a disability works in the parliament, so that the real life of a person with disability will be worked out in the legislation. And it was I haven't worked before in the People's Party. It was a high risk for the party and also for me. And before I was very engaged at an NGO for inclusive education and at the beginning there was a lot of insecure from the other colleagues. How should we speak with him? How should we greet him? Because I don't shake hands. That's a bit unusual for a politician. It works very good. I have a not a very loud voice, but my colleagues learn to listen at low voices, and we reached a lot of appointments.
We reached a lot.
Okay.
Thank you very much. So let's dive into employment issues, which is the main topic of our conference of these 3 days. And our first question goes to my left, to Senator Conway. So we heard you are the Irish Senate spokesperson on justice, disability and equality. And Ireland, as you probably know, has undergone a very deep recession with an unemployment rate that rose to 14.8% in 2012, which hit also hard many persons with disabilities. It seems now that the country is back on track with an employment rate that decreased to about 8% in spring 2016. And very interestingly, in 2015, it developed a 10-year comprehensive employment strategy for people with disabilities. So this has been launched 2 years ago, so it's not much time, but still, we would like to know from Senator Conway, do you consider the step per se as a success? What is the status of its implementation? And what, in your view, still needs to be improved?
Okay, Ingrid. Actually, the figures for unemployment were released yesterday for 2017, for all of 2016, and it's now actually at 6.2%. So Ireland has now over 2 million people working, 2,050,000 people working. But unfortunately, when it comes to disability and people who have disabilities, our record is extremely poor. You are correct. We had a very difficult and very deep recession, which kicked off in 2008-2009. Prior to that, our record in terms of employment of people with disabilities was significantly below the European average. So you can imagine then when the recession hit, and hit very hard, that got worse. We had a situation where we were in a bailout for about 2 years after 2011. We went into a bailout in December 2010. The government's number one priority was to rescue the economy and try and get us out of the bailout in Ireland. And they did succeed in doing that. They also set up various action plans to create employment, which were very focused and very targeted, and they started in 2012. But there was no comprehensive strategy, no proper focused approach for getting people who had various disabilities working. In Ireland, of blind and visually impaired people, who I would have a particular knowledge of, only 16% of people between 18 and 64 actually are in paid employment. So flip that, we are in a situation where 84% of them are unemployed, whereas in a lot of other European countries, it's 30 to 40% of people of that age bracket are in employment. So really, we're starting from an extremely low base. Yes, it's correct, we're 2 years into the comprehensive employment strategy, which was a focused effort by government to pull all of the agencies together, get them to work in unison to try and improve the figures. Has it worked? I regret to say it hasn't really shown any significant improvements yet. It is a 10-year strategy. We are just under 2 years into it. I think it was launched in October, November 2015. So we're probably a year and a half into it. We're coming from a low base. It's probably going to take time. What should be done? I think we need to see a lot more in Ireland, a lot more of what you were talking about over lunch today in terms of role models within the private sector. There's a lot of unique, good examples, but not enough of them. We need to change the attitudes of business people, human resource managers, and we need to provide incentives to assist them in changing their attitudes. That's a cultural thing as much as anything else. And yes, it has to be done. We now have a new government that's almost a year in office. For the first time, we have a senior cabinet minister with specific responsibilities for disability. It's something that we haven't had before. There was a 40% increase in funding to various disability organisations in the last budget for 2017, whereas up until then we saw significant cuts. So we have a long way to go, but we have taken a number of baby steps, which one would have to be hopeful. And certainly the comprehensive employment strategy is trying to bring all of the good that's out there with various organisations and NGOs and various state agencies in a focused, collaborative way where hopefully there will be tangible results. And we can only judge these things by results. And 2 years out of 10 is probably early days, but I would live in hope. But I would be disappointed that we haven't had some early wins and early successes, because I certainly believe that early wins and early successes gives credibility to a strategy, and we haven't had them, unfortunately.
Thank you, Mr. Conway. I'm now directed my question to Mr. Huaining. You say before that in 2002 you have been elected for the first time member of the as a first wheelchair user of the Austrian Parliament. So it's 15 years now. So it's a long time. I believe that in 15 years you have faced many political achievements also in terms of rights of people with disability regarding employment. Can you refer precisely to three of them?
The first achievement to mention is, of course, the ratification of the UN Convention we made 2008 in Parliament, and we have monitoring committee which looks that the goals are worked out, and we have made a national action plan from 2012 to 2020, and with nine key topics and 250 measures, and so there's a lot to do. There's also the umbrella organization, they are working with experts from all parts of institutions together to bring them together and to bring solutions. The second thing is the Disability Equality Act. It is especially for accessibility and anti-discrimination, and we made a very good tool. The name is Schlichtungsverfahren. So before you can go to court and but before you there's the possibility to bring the people together to talk about possible solutions, and in 50% they find solutions and they don't have to go to the court, and so that's, I think, a very good way to handle about. And the third thing is the sign language, which is now a minority language, an accepted minority language in the constitution. And this was very hard to realize, to work out in Parliament, because there were a lot of clichés and prejudice, and especially pedagogics means that the kids shouldn't speak in a sign language, then they don't learn the normal way of speaking aloud. Speaking and but now it's the velour. Yeah.
Thank you. Many sites, many things to do. Indeed, the National Action Plan, the Disability Equality Act. I think there's also some reform coming up of in this field. But let's switch now to the European Union level and let's hear from our representative from the European Commission. How is actually the European Commission complementing national policy making in the field of disability employment? Are there maybe control mechanisms? And what sort of means of communications exist? And how can they be improved?
Thank you, Ingrid, for the interesting but at the same time very complex question. When it comes to disability policy, the bulk of the responsibilities in Europe lays still with the member states. It is there are a lot of national responsibilities in relation to social protection, in relation to employment. There are other areas which relate more to the internal market, for example, for which or transport, where there is much more activity and competence at European level. In all the cases, we work very closely together with the member states. When we develop policies to support or to coordinate or to exchange information with the member states through different mechanisms. Of course, each of the European institutions, I come from the Commission, but we have the European Parliament, the Council, and us, the European Commission, and each of the institutions maintain that link with the national levels through their own methods. I mean, you heard in the previous session in this room, representative of the European Parliament coming from Poland. There will be another one coming from Belgium tomorrow. And we work together with the European Parliament and as an institution in what we call the interinstitutional interinstitutional arrangements. We have our own working methods. And also with member states directly in council, we discuss the policies, the proposals for legislations, for example, at the Commission, informal settings in which council members from representing their own countries bring their own positions, and we try to achieve at the end a European results. That is in the interinstitutional setting. Then, as European Commission, we also have our direct links with member states. For example, we have in the area of disability an expert group called the European the High Level Group on Disability. And their experts from member states responsible for disability policies come together with the Commission and also together with disability organizations that operate at European level. And we discuss different policy initiatives, legislative measures, and so forth. For example, we discuss with them the implementation of the Convention. We discuss thematic areas. For example, last year we published a report that was being done together in which each member state explained what are they doing in the area of employment and vocational training, how it is approached in the different countries, what type of measures are there, what type of incentives, what type of legislative framework beyond the European framework, because we also have a European framework in relation to employment of disabled persons that for which we as a Commission have the obligation to monitor its proper implementation at national level. This is, for example, the directive that protects persons with disabilities from discrimination in the area of employment. This has been done. Then there are cases during the implementation that are brought to the European Court of Justice, for which then common interpretations of the European legislation is being set through jurisprudence, and this goes back to the national level applying the directive in a uniform way. For example, to give you an example of those two elements, there has been a couple of court cases at European level about the definition of disability. What is disability in the context of the Employment Equality Directive? This definition has been evolving through jurisprudence to get more in line with the UN Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disability, having been the first interpretation much more made based on a medical model. And we see that shift happening, and that will permeate then to the national levels. As another example of how we monitor the proper implementation or adequate implementation of EU law, there was the transposition of the concept of reasonable accommodation in one member state, and then the Commission took action in order to ensure that that transposition was done properly. In terms of policy measures, we other policy measures, for example, there is support or a policy framework being set, for example, so that the state aid allows for the use of financial support in order to employ persons with disabilities. Also, we have we work very closely together with member states authorities for the implementation of the social funds. It is a fund that relates or can be used for social inclusion of persons with disabilities, and then it's the management of those funds are shared management. So this means that member states have a big role in implementing and in expanding those funds, in management of the funds, and we work very closely together with the management authorities to make the best use of those funds. Finally, we, through the support that we are providing to European level NGOs, so to civil society, we support them in participating at European level in the policy discussions, but also their members are national. And these levels of discussions at European level again permeate the national level through their national members. So as you see, I mean, we provide support through a collection of data, exchanges of best practices. In relation to monitor, I would not want to call it monitor, as you asked about monitoring exactly, but it is or controlling. You said controlling. I would say about monitoring, collecting data about the situation of disabled persons. A very useful thing that we are doing is to get comparable data on the employment situation of disabled people for each member state and see how that compares with persons without disabilities, and what is also, we provide data about the European average. So we try to put evidence on the table on the situation and see how that those figures are progressing. So to summarize, quite a wide range of initiatives and methods of working together in order to achieve a common goal of improving the employment situation.
Thank you very much, Immaculada. So we have learned now about the European level. So I want now to ask my question to the national level. So Mr. Conway first. How do you see the interaction between the EU at the national level and its impact on the rights of people with disability, in particular when it comes to vocational training and employment?
I would consider it critical. Of course, Brexit is a word that's very popular and disturbing, really, in Ireland at the minute, because obviously our relationship with the European Union as a country is extremely important to us. And how we are going to interact with Europe post-Brexit is extremely important to us as well. Because we joined the European Union in the early 70s because Britain joined, and we were really seen as effectively a one nation, although we are very, very separate and we are not one nation, but because the intricacies and the engagement and the level of trade and so forth between Ireland and England was so significant, when England joined it, it was a natural thing for us then to join it. Fast forward to 2017 and the triggering of Article 50, it's going to certainly create a whole new narrative between Ireland and Europe. Thankfully, in terms of an economy. We're not as dependent as we were on England and the UK, but that said, we are still very dependent. So, like, you know, the narrative in terms of Europe and Ireland is very much going to be defined over the next a couple of years. In terms of disability policy, the European Union and Ireland, Ireland would be very much supportive and very much would want to engage and do what is set at European level. The fact that we are now just weeks away from ratifying the UN Convention on the Rights of Disability means that Ireland effectively has signed up to all international understandings when it comes to disability. Naturally, as an island nation, we will continue to require support from Europe. And, you know, the various initiatives that are embarked upon for equality in general for Ireland will continue to require the financial support of our colleagues in the European Union.
Thank you very much, Mr. Conway. I just would like to say to the audience that after the intervention of Mr. Wanning, we will get some questions. So be ready, please. So, Mr. Wanning, could you please respond from the Austrian side? Thank you.
Sorry, for the break. Sometimes the need also breaks. In the work with the national parliament and the European Parliament, this work together could be improved. Should be improved. Because sometimes one hand doesn't know what the other is doing. And I think that the European Disability Forum and the UAE as an umbrella organization does here a very good work because they inform the members of parliament what is going on or when legislation is sticking that we should do something, we should work together nationally and European side, then they say hello, you have to do something like now in the European Accessibility Act, and so we hope that it will improve.
Thank you very much.
Okay, everyone. So we are ready for your questions to our panelists. Panelists can also ask questions, and we moderators have another list of questions, but I think the time won't suffice. So you have the first go. I see a hand up there. I think it's Professor Pujalte. Is somebody else in the line? Okay, Mr. Zeldler. Okay, wonderful. So first, then Luke. Yes.
My question is a very brief question to Senator Conway, and it is, what is the situation in Ireland on the ratification of the UN Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities?
Okay.
Let's collect some questions, and then we give it back to the panelists. Thank you. So another question was there in the back. Luc Zedalo.
Thank you, Ingrid. Indeed, Luxel de los Secretary General, ESPD, a network of support services for persons with disabilities. Actually, I have two questions. I have a question for Emma, and I have a question for the two other speakers. The work that is done by the European Union and by the European Commission on the Accessibility Act is absolutely essential. It is very good work, it is outstanding work, but at this stage it's blocked by some member states and by employers. So my question to EMA is, what can a gathering such as the one we have here in Vienna do to help de-block the situation? Because we really need a strong Accessibility Act. Accessibility is essential when we want to facilitate employment on the open labour market. So I'm sure that Emma has a few good ideas on how we can support her very important and very good work. Second question to the two other speakers. Quite often we see that the real bottleneck is the lack of communication and cooperation with employers, with the business world. So my question to the two speakers is whether they have examples on how authorities, national authorities, legal authorities, engage with employers, open labor market employers, to facilitate employment of persons with a disability. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Luc, for these very pertinent questions. Over here, I see somebody else, please.
Hi, thank you. My name is Irad, I'm from Israel, and I wanted to ask Parliament member Mr. Conway, can you please elaborate a little bit more about your 10 years plan? What did you do till now and what you're planning to do? Thank you.
Thank you. The lady next to you.
Hello, I'm Daphna from Israel as well. I'm working for the government of Israel, and one of the issues that we meet these few months, or actually few years, is the fact that we can't find enough people. The gentleman from behind asked about the connection with the employers. We have actually few centers to support employers. We have a lot of positions, but the main problem is to find the people with disabilities to suit these positions. Thank you.
Very important. You need also the people with disabilities if you have the job opportunities. Somebody else? I see no hand. Ah, somebody hidden behind the camera. Yeah.
Yes, hello. This is Fulya from Turkey. I want to ask about vocational training. In which level does vocational training begin in your country, in secondary school or in high school, etc.? And how government does decide which vocational trainings should be in the curriculum? Do they speak with the representatives from labor market, or do they analyze the staff needs of real market? This is my question.
Thank you very much. Very important question. Oh, here, yeah, I forgot someone. This is the last one now, and then we go back to the panels.
Thank you. I'm from Turkey, and we are working for human research. Turkey is signed to UN Disabled Policy in 2005. They are working in Turkey still, but some accessibility date is going or they are waiting many things still. One of them is accessibility because of the for employment we need sustainable. I mean, when the disabled people start to work, it took a little time, 1 month, 2 months, 3 months. We always trying to private sector. It should go on, we are asking about the UN policy, how you control the country about this situation. Thank you.
So I understand how you control how long the job is given to a person?
UN policy, Turkey accepted 2005, but it's still going on. And do you have any control mechanism about this?
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
So, gives the word back to the panelists. Let's start on the left, Senator Conway.
Okay, thank you for the range of questions. In terms of the UN Convention on the Rights of People with Disabilities being ratified in Ireland, the reason it hasn't been ratified up until now was we had a number of pieces of legislation to pass through Parliament that was difficult and challenging in nature. Particularly around to do with various people who had mental health challenges and intellectual disabilities, particularly in the whole area of capacity legislation. That has all been done now, so there is no roadblocks remaining. So it's just a matter of just crossing the T's and dotting the I's. And the Convention for the Rights of People with Disabilities will be ratified, I would imagine, during this Oireachtas term. So I would be very hopeful that it will be done this side of Easter. In terms of the Comprehensive Employment Strategy, it's the first time that Ireland has actually engaged to pull all of the various stakeholders together to get them to work together in a focused and driven way. We are about a year and a half into this strategy. It's a strategy that encompasses all of the various government agencies. Also, the trade union movement have had an input into it, and also the private sector. And the goal is to get more people with disabilities back to work. In order to move this forward and to drive it, because to be quite honest, it has really been stalled since it began, and that is my view. We now have a minister appointed at senior government level for the first time in Ireland. We have somebody sitting, as we call it, the cabinet table, with specific responsibilities for disabilities. It's taken that minister some time to get used to this role and to engage. So I would hope that minister, along with the jobs minister, will drive the strategy forward. But really, as we say at home, the proof of the pudding is in the eating, and we will know when the jobs are created for people with disabilities and the job opportunities that are there if people with disabilities succeed in getting through the interview process. I was involved in the establishment of an organisation in Ireland called AHEAD, which is the Association for Higher Education Access for People with Disabilities to Third Level Education. And while a lot of the roadblocks for people at third level for people with disabilities accessing third level were overcome, unfortunately there are in our country, in Ireland, still significant roadblocks in terms of people making the next step into paid employment. And there has been a number of small initiatives like the WAM, the Willing Able Mentoring Programme, where people with disabilities got paid internships, and from that it led on to paid employment. So I suppose the employment strategy is looking at a whole host of different areas to try and, you know, just deal with the roadblocks that are there. But it hasn't, and there's no point in anybody saying it has been successful so far. It hasn't. And we haven't had, as I've said earlier, any early wins with it. But I would always be optimistic that at least there is a strategy in place, at least there is a very senior person at the heart of government now driving the whole disability agenda. So if it's not working and it's found not to be working in any year's time, I imagine it will be reviewed. I think that was all for me, was it?
Yeah. Thank you very much. Yeah. There was one question about the lack of cooperation with businesses. Maybe you quickly want to go on that.
Yeah, there was. Unfortunately, there was no formalised structure in place engagement with the private sector. There are no quotas for the private sector, and there is no incentives to achieve quotas for the private sector. In the public sector, the civil and public service, there is a quota of 3%, and to be fair to a lot of the government departments, they have actually exceeded that number in terms of people, certainly with physical disabilities, gaining employment. In the private sector, we have a long way to go to achieve anything like that. And, I would hope that we will see a much further engagement. And conferences like this, the Zero Project conferences, that start a conversation with business and use role models of businesses that have been successfully ran and have successful people within their movements with disabilities is important. And, I would just say that, hopefully we will see a much greater interaction with the private and business in Ireland, which we haven't had up until now.
Thank you very much. So another step to do. Honourable HUAINIGG.
Well, I also think that Zero Project Conference it's a big success for the dialogue between employers and people with disability. And the Martin Essel makes a very good work, and he's planning now in 9 dialogue forums in the counties, and I think so. And this dialogue should be between politicians and employers and people with disability, and this is the way to get rid of clichés and
prejudices.
I also, as politician, often I have contact with employers. I write letters. One letter is I wrote to the chief of the Rewe Konzern, Billa, and Mr. Hensel, the lead of the concern here. He said, I got a very mean letter of the parliament, and they came to the parliament, and we talked together, and they really changed their politic, and now they have a program for accessibility of the supermarkets, and also they are working out employee program. Another example, I think we have to be creative in finding jobs, and we have to think out of the box, and I had an idea that people with learning disabilities should be journalism training, and they should work at a newspaper, and I contacted a big newspaper, the Courier, and then first they didn't want, but later on they said, okay, let's try it. And now there is a course of six people with learning disability, and they write the daily writing news in simple language, and this is what's their capacity and what they can do, and the other journalists can't do, and so they learn from each other, and this is, I think, the way we have to go and to find new jobs. This is the institution. It's a hard work, so the institution is here. The institution. It's not only hard to speak it out, only hard to bring it in the progress. But we have to do it.
Thank you very much to wonderful best practices from Austria. So please write more letters. That seems to have also all of you start to write letters. Amnesty has a great success with that. So maybe we should start to write more letters.
In the letter, I include a chocolate.
So, a little bit of corruption also allowed.
Maybe
not too finish. Much. Wonderful. I would like to ask our panelists to get ready in one sentence their takeaway message for the audience. And you can think about it a little bit whilst Immaculada is sharing her answers to the questions.
Okay. The question was what can be done, what is the process now, basically, I think, what is happening with the Accessibility Act and how you can have your views being taken on board. I would like to, and because I think that's the Act is not blocked. I mean, I have to say, the Act, the discussions on the Act are not blocked. They are very, very alive. Discussions happening, and I think and I really hope that that will lead to a good result. But I think it's important that it is well understood what is happening now with the Act. The Commission adopted a proposal about a year ago, a bit more than a year ago. And the process now, what is happening now, is that member states in Council and members of the Parliament, in the European Parliament, are getting their positions about that piece of paper, and simplifying a lot, but in order to clarify what the process is. So the Council, so the member states in Council, will reach what is called a common position, saying this is our view on the Commission proposal. We like it, we don't like it, we want more, we want less. That is what will happen. Then the European Parliament will produce a report, I mean, it's happening in parallel, in which they would go through a similar process. And finally, the three institutions, Commission, Council, and Parliament, will come together and reach an agreement on a final document. Now, the Commission proposal is public. You all know what our thoughts were. Parliament and Council are at the process of forming their positions before the discussion. So what can you do to get your views brought into the process? You can, of course, talk to them. The Commission, by the way, following the better regulation, the recent better regulation package, we had a public consultation after the proposal was on the table to get the views of the public on the Commission proposal. And that document is published. You can see what was the answer to that. But now the process is on the Council, it's on the Parliament, so I would say talk to your member states, talk to your members of Parliament to share your views with them and follow the process in detail, because there will be different possibilities for you to give your views to this process. As I said, we don't know how long it will take. What is very important is that there is an agreement, a paper called the Joint Declaration, in which the three institutions, Commission, Parliament and Council, has decided that the Accessibility Act, the adoption of the Accessibility Act, is a priority for 2017. So there is really an objective to reach an agreement by the end of the year. That was the intention of that document. But we are in the at the beginning of the process, and I hope that objective will be fulfilled. Thank you.
I would like to thank you, all the panelists, for the interventions. And before closing the session and hand over to the keynote speak, the keynote speech afterwards, I would just start from my left to ask you for your 30-second, 1 minute maximum message to give to the public.
30 seconds, I need to end up. Employers who says it doesn't work with disability, people with disabilities can't be included. They haven't tried it, and but employers who have tried it often says yes, well, it works. So I think that's the way that motivate them to have a direct contact and to try to employ a person with disability and yeah, this, yeah, so thanks.
Thank you for your message. Mr. Conway, your message.
Okay, just in terms of a final comment, you know, the whole theme of this event is about employment. We all want equality. We all want no barriers. The one way I believe in securing equality is by people having the opportunity to work and contribute to society. That is the one leveler. It's the one way of creating an equal society. And I think as policymakers throughout Europe and as NGOs, and I've spoken to many NGOs and researchers who are here at this conference, we all have a responsibility to work hard to ensure that accessibility to employment is a right that's achieved, not just aspired to.
Thank you very much. I think we all agree. Immaculada Plasencia, your message?
Well, I think that in this area of employment, there are still a lot of misconceptions and lack of knowledge of how to persons with disabilities can participate in employment. Although it might sound like a cliche, I think that still there is a necessity to have resource centers, places where employers that want to employ persons with disabilities can go and say, what do I do? Where do I start? And I think these conferences can help to put those information together, but having it in a more structured way, it's still needed in Europe. Sharing resources, how do we do it? That is where we should be working harder. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, and we will leave the stage immediately and hand over to Caroline Casey.